Subscribe to our YouTube channel for in-depth interviews of India Inc. and press the bell icon so that you do not miss our updates.
Hello and welcome to Nirmal Bang, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Hiral Dadia. We have with us Mr. Rohit Katyal, Executive Director and CFO at Capacity Infra Projects, joining in. Welcome to the show, Mr. Katyal, and a pleasure to speak to you as always. Let's begin with the overall, health check of the real estate industry and the construction industry as a whole. How would you describe it pre-COVID and post-COVID? How has it changed?
So as we all know, from the real estate sector perspective, pre-COVID, there was a lot of pessimism, dropping sales, uncertainty on the GST, higher interest rate regime, which surprisingly and extremely good for the industry as a whole has changed 360 degree post-COVID. So the quarter three, while the recovery started a little bit from quarter two of the current financial year, quarter three saw a complete 360 degree turn, which meant that most reputed companies saw lifetime high sales and therefore much improved cash flows. And that same optimism has gone into quarter four. So pre-COVID and post-COVID for the real estate industry cannot be compared. Pre was full of pessimism, especially after the IL&FS debacle in 2018. Post-COVID has given a fresh air of optimism for the real estate sector and therefore a good opportunity in the private sector space for the construction sector as well. The construction segment which you are referring to, I am now talking about the contracting fraternity related to building construction. Because if the real estate does well, it gives a good opportunity for companies like us, L&T, Shapoorji, NCC, to bid and therefore have an improved revenue. And the health of good real estate sector means better cash flows. So that also augurs well for the balance sheet. We would like to say that post-COVID, the good companies have become better. So whether it's the Oberoi's of the world or Godrej or Brookfield, or any of the clients which you see in our client list, they have improved for the better because their cash flows have improved. They were already strong companies with strong balance sheet. So this gives us a good visibility for order inflow as we go into the next financial year. Similarly, on the government side, the focus always of the government once COVID set in was expenditure on healthcare, institutional buildings, and PMAY affordable housing. That continues. So this is from the construction perspective.
Right. So Mr. Katyal, have you seen consolidation happening in the industry? And do you think, if yes, that's something that could affect a company like yours?
See, consolidation will only happen when a stronger company takes over the projects of a weaker real estate company, or the opportunity may come through a sale in the NCLT. I'm talking about the real estate. The clients which we work for are on the stronger side, if not the best in the industry. So if any consolidation happens, it will be in benefit to Capacity and not against it, because our existing clients will have more projects to offer to us.
Right. And overall, what are the challenges that we've been facing during such times? And do you think we are still ahead of the challenges already? Or are we already on recovery mode yet?
So the first 6 months, to be very honest, was a wipeout, especially in the big metros where the COVID issue was then followed by the workmen migration, reverse migration issue, and so on and so forth. However, from quarter three onwards, we saw some stability coming back. And from quarter four, you will see growth. And therefore, we do believe that the challenges from workmen perspective, from staffing perspective, supply chain perspective, or from logistics perspective, they are more or less behind us. We look with optimism towards the next financial year on back of our strong order book And I, for one, do not believe that the government will take any harsh action as far as shutdowns or impacting the project sites are concerned. It only happened in India. Nowhere in the world were the construction sites shut down. And I therefore believe that any increase in COVID cases here on also will not pose any challenge for a construction site or construction companies.
Right. And overall, for a company like yours being a core EPC player on the private side and the government side, what are the growth drivers from here on? Because a lot of impetus right now is on infrastructure development.
See, infrastructure development is a very big umbrella. Again, under that, you have healthcare separately. As far as government is concerned, you have affordable housing, you have economic weaker sections housing. So on healthcare alone, the government, central government, has given out a budget of close to 70,000 crore over the next 4 years. Now you can take that 4x, 5x when you add state government budgets on healthcare. Similarly, on PMAY, each state under the PMAY housing scheme with central government funding aid and some coming from state is a very, very big sector and therefore provides a lot of visibility over the next 5 years. Having said that, the private sector pleasantly has come back. You will see a lot of new launches starting Q1 next financial year. Therefore, as a whole, we do believe that the bid pipeline is extremely strong for the next 24 months at least. That's a midterm. On short-term basis, we have a visibility of approximately 46,000 crores in the geographies where we work. Obviously, we will not be bidding and taking everything of that. We have a target which we will be pursuing. And I do believe with this strong bid pipeline, coupled with our order backlog, we should be easily be able to do that.
Right. And from the private players, do you think there is a risk of non-payment? Have you booked any provisions already in the year gone by?
See, ECL came after Ind AS 116, and that's happening for the last 2 years. So after the ILFS debacle, where certain of our clients were basically financing their projects on basis of NBFCs, we started making provisions. And therefore, as we speak to you today, as on 31st December 2020, the total provisionings on ECL, expected credit loss from clients, stand as at 60 crores, which means there are no surprises which may come in the next year and year after that, suddenly we have to provide 50 crores. So adequate provisioning is there. Having said that, we do believe that these provisions will start reversing from next year onwards because some of the weak clients will be taken over by stronger clients. Like Radius Harbor Heights has been taken over by Adani Real Estate. Similarly, Radius Avenue 54, that was with DHFL, which has been taken over by Piramal. So this is what will happen going forward. As far as provisions are concerned, we are very comfortable.
Right. And then on the execution front, you know, there were a lot of hiccups in the first 3 to 6 months due to labor, etc. By when do you expect execution to return to normalcy? Or do you think we're already back to normal and maybe exceeding that from here on?
So we believe that the March quarter four of current fiscal has brought normalcy back. And you will see growth here on. Quarter on quarter from.
And overall, if you have to talk about the CIDCO project, where are we on the execution front? And when do we see peak revenue starting to flow in for the project?
So CIDCO project has can be divided into 7 locations. 6 locations, we have already started the work in full swing. The 7th location was Sector 43, where there were certain encroachment issues. And the client, in lieu of that, has already handed over Nawade plot in Taloja, where about 34 buildings of 27 stories would come up. Which means that all the 7 sites will start operations from Q1 of next financial year. Coming to the revenue part, we believe that the start any project has a peaking trajectory. So, for example, we are already billing 25 crores per month over there at the moment.
Okay.
With this to go up to 35 crores in quarter one, quarter two to 45 crores, the three at another 15 crores, and then we should peak in quarter four of next financial year. However, the overall project has to be completed in 43 months year on. And therefore, you will see that the next 3 years will be strong as far as Sidco project is concerned.
And similarly for the Mahada project also, which is ongoing right now, Mr. Katyal, if you could just help us understand what is the timeline for this project and what's the kind of revenue contribution we could see?
See, this project of Mahada, BDD Chawl redevelopment, is a joint venture between Tata Projects and Capacity Infra. It's an integrated joint venture. And there was an issue of the department or the client giving us the right of way or the free land to start construction. However, on December 29th, a government resolution has been brought in whereby the height of the rehabilitation 22 story earlier has been increased to 40 stories.
Okay.
Which means that the footprint area or the ground area required has reduced by nearly 60%. And therefore, we are targeting to start construction at the project site by 15th April. And you will see substantial revenues starting next financial year, which will start peaking from FY22-23 onwards. But 22-23 onwards, you can take a consolidated revenues in the joint venture of close to 800 crores average. Completion period, our share is 35%, just to clarify.
Right. And then with this...
Going forward, it is important to note that... So the rehab portion is about 5,000 crore.
Yeah.
The sale component is approximately 4,000 crore.
Okay.
And the commercial component is close to 1,000 crore. This is the lump sum turnkey design build portion of the full contract.
Right. And with this, the order book that it stands at is around 9,150 odd crores. So does by how much are we looking to expand it further in FY22? And what's the bid pipeline looking like? What's going to be the strategy on that front?
See, as far as order book is concerned, on our next year's projections, we are already sitting at 4.25x on standalone basis. If you, on the consolidated basis, it's much more because our share in Mahada is close to 4,300 crores. And therefore, looking into this, this gives us an opportunity to pick and choose over the next 16, 18 months. And therefore, our internal target is to close institutional buildings and certain projects from existing clients to the tune of approximately 2,800 to 3,000 crores in FY22.
Okay. And overall, if you see in the recent con call, you're guided for a revenue of around 2,000 plus crores in FY22. Do you think this is the kind of run rate we will continue with in future as well? Or do you think, is this a one-off?
The order book, ma'am, is 9185 excluding Mahada. And assuming that we don't take any further order, hypothetically speaking, even then, you have to complete all this order book over the next 4 year period. So, the run rate has to be approximately 20%. We intend to close these projects within the revised delivery timelines. And therefore, I do believe on the basis of our book, our established strength, that the growth which we hope in the next year will continue to grow over the next 3 to 4 years. That's intermediate future.
Right. And on the margin front as well, will we be able to maintain the current margin trend with strong cost control measures, economies of scale flowing in? Or do you think we will see softening, especially from the large-scale operations that we have been undertaking?
even after having started SIDCO, you will have seen that there is no increase in debt level. On the contrary, we are on the reduction speed. There is no increase in the overall salary levels. Now, if we start comparing with FY21, it will be difficult because this year, 6 months were literally wiped off for us.
Correct.
Having said this, we do believe that the EBITDA levels of design component in 65% of our projects. And I do believe that this trend will continue. Having said that, if we do better, you all can say thank you. Well done. However, guidance remains at 16.8 to 17.5.
Right. And overall, if you see on the working capital cycle, that has been stretched. When do you think we could come back to normalcy on that front?
You have to see capacities and net working capital cycle over the last 4-5 years. Just before the ILFS debacle, September 2018, our net working capital was 56 days excluding retention, which went up because of the payments which got stuck with a couple of clients to 72 days as of March 2020. Now, of course, COVID period, nothing happened for a period of 6 months, but you already have. We do believe that by December of the next financial year, more or less, we should be at the pre-ILFS level. Forget the pre-COVID level. So that's the target which we have internally set. And if you look at the cash inflows, the reduction in debtor levels, reduction in creditor levels over the past, even for 31st December, and the collections which we have been getting, it is...
Right.
Hello. And,
yes, can you hear me? Yeah. And lastly, overall on the debt front as well, you've guided to be debt free. What's the kind of timeline we could be looking at?
We have given ourselves time till June 2023, even take away one quarter. However, we stand committed. Our cash flows, net cash from business, from operations have been always very robust. We have reinvested them for capex. Now, with enough capex being available, and the next 3 years, you will see the capex level reducing because there is enough core assets with the company for the type of projects we have taken. So, the cash availability with the company will be sizable. And having given that, we do believe on increased revenues, we should be in a position to clear our gross debt by June of 2023. We have to remember that even as we speak to you today, our net debt is only 40 crores.
Correct.
So a large portion of that money is lying in fixed deposit. Due to COVID, banks were apprehensive. As we move into the next financial year, I think the banks will start supporting. Maybe the margins will come down. So while we see about 150 crores to 175 crores from operations for debt reduction, the remainder we look from our fixed deposit for debt reduction. So on one hand, the debt will go down, little bit of fixed deposits will go down. However, aim is to be gross debt free by June of 23.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Katyal, so much for getting us this candid commentary from your end. It was a pleasure to speak to you. Hope to speak to you soon again. Stay safe and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.